am very glad to inform you that our business has turned out very satisfactorily. Indeed, during the past year, notwithstanding that much has militated against our progress, before dealing with the figures in the accounts, I think it is necessary for me to recall to your minds what I said at our last meeting. You will probably remember these words: on this occasion, we have to meet an adverse balance, and it is deemed necessary to take immediate steps to improve our position. At the beginning of the year, we brought forward a substantial amount, and now we are faced with a deficit. I am persuaded, however, that we could not have done better owing to the peculiar circumstances which were in operation during the year. Those who were present at the meeting in all probability remember the statement on this matter in the report. It was felt that by some means we must regain our position, and therefore every circumstance likely to have affected the profitable working of the company was considered, and the result reflects great credit on all those who are concerned in the reorganization, and I think that you are satisfied in this respect. Dear sir, I am very glad to notice that by some means you are hoping to have the new proposal brought forward at the next meeting of the directors, and I am persuaded that in the meantime you should not discuss the matter with anyone, because it is necessary to be very cautious in all circumstances, as on this occasion you will probably do what we can be done to make the case complete, so that we may have every circumstance detailed that is in our favor. I think that you are aware of the importance of having ready a definite scheme. If we would be successful, but as the matter is of such vital importance to us, I take the liberty of emphasizing the point. Awaiting your reply, we are yours truly. Turning to the accounts for the year now under review, I think you will agree with me that we have done exceedingly well on the credit side of the trading account. You will find that the business done shows an increase of £20,000. On the other side, we show an increase of working expenses, but the increase is not heavy and furnishes us with an example of the fact that the better the business we do, the lower is the ratio of expenses. On the assets side of the balance sheet, the property account item is the same as before, while the cash shows an increase of £1,200. On the liabilities side of the balance sheet, the cost of renovation has been charged to the reserve account, and I think you will quite agree with this. Our dividends for the past 5 years have averaged 10% per annum. Early in the coming year, there will be a special meeting to discuss the matter of further developments, and I take the liberty of urging all to be present. In the meantime, I trust we shall continue to prosper so that we may have a substantial increase in our profits. Dear sir, I am certain that you are not fully conversant with the matter, or you would not urge those who were present on these occasions to bring the question to the notice of the meeting. On either side, there are those who are always ready to hurry business as fast as they can, notwithstanding that there is no advantage gained by unnecessary haste. By and by, I am inclined to think that you will agree with me on this matter, and then you will regret that you unduly hastened the passing of the rules with which we are now dealing. Yours truly. It is said that civilization has deprived man of his love of nature, and it is only necessary to observe the small proportion of city dwellers who delight in the out-of-doors life to find confirmation of this statement. This has been spoken of many times, and as we think and as we shall maintain, it is very unfortunate that such a state of affairs exists. Nature is ever striving after perfection, and this is the one great lesson of life we have to learn, that the greatest happiness is to be found in the pursuit of perfection, for as Stevenson says, it is more blessed to travel than to arrive. All lovers of nature should read Stevenson's account of a leisurely journey through the northeast of France by canoe and on foot. He has a lover of nature being in perfect agreement with him and wishing to emulate his example. We spent a holiday afloat in France last summer. We have been informed of the proposed meeting of your country association on Wednesday next, and to us it appears that as soon as the members realize the state of affairs, they will be only too glad to postpone a definite decision. We are of the opinion that there are many who have not agreed with the attitude of the executive and who do not wish the proposals to be carried into effect. At all events, at all our own recent country gatherings, which have been rather smaller than usual, there has been much objection to several proposals on this subject, and as soon as we can, we are having a postal vote, as we cannot decide certain matters without knowing the opinion of members who have not been in attendance to express in views on the questions. Three of us had arranged to make the trip. All of us are members of the same political association, while two are also prominently connected with the medical association and the third with the traders association. On a Wednesday evening, we left the shores of England for France. Arriving in Paris, we hired a flat-bottomed Norwegian boat, somewhat smaller than we had intended, and from this city we rowed ourselves down to Nantes. Leaving Paris On a Thursday afternoon, we went to the scene, along two canals, and down the lorry, a distance of over 300 miles, which occupied a joyous month, out of which we spent more than half the time on the water. We had a very large umbrella that protected us absolutely from sun and showers, and in the locker of the boat there were appliances for the preparation of simple meals. As well as can be remembered, we went through about 40 locks. We stayed at 30 inns, and our expenses worked out to a total of 20 francs a day for dinner, bed, and early breakfast. It will take longer than we expected to finish the premises for the political association, but we shall be able to get all the out-of-doors work finished before the winter sets in, and then it can only be a matter of weeks for the completion of the interior. Anyway, we shall be no longer than we can help. When finished, the building will be one of the handsome in this city. The weather was glorious during the whole trip, and our picnic lunches under the trees, though of the very simplest character, were most enjoyable. Looking back upon the time, it appears we were in such excellent spirits that what we ate was of little consequence. We gloried in the fact that we were in the real France of the real French, and were enjoying nature among new and strange surroundings. We have been informed that we did not take the best route, and therefore as soon as we can, we shall take the opportunity of carrying into effect the suggested alternative. Let us urge those who have not experienced such a holiday to try it by all means as soon as they can, since it seems to us that in these days of advanced civilization, it is necessary that we seek communion with nature whenever we can, and especially at holiday times. In our statement at the Traders Association on Thursday evening, it will only be necessary to mention briefly the high rate of interest to be charged for the loan on the new buildings, as we shall have a full discussion of the whole matter at the next meeting. All the voting cards have been returned, and in nearly all cases, the vote is in favor of the present president continuing in office. We shall be able to purchase the materials at first cost, and as we do a very large turnover, our profits should exceed rather than fall below those of last year, as well as can be estimated beforehand. We shall have to increase our stocks at all our own depots, and as we may also require a new debt at action, a new depot at Acton, we shall be obliged to increase the initial order. In view of this, we shall expect prices to be much lower than the old rates. From time to time, we have discussed the question of the influence of the press, and you cannot deny that on all occasions I have been able to make out a fairly strong case for the justification of the statement that journalists on the whole work for the cause of progress. And if you should not be willing to allow this, they would be unduly condemned for that for which they were not altogether responsible. You will recollect that some time ago, I cannot say the exact date, you stated that you were not satisfied that the influence of the press was for good. I would not reopen this question as soon again if it were not for the speech of one of our leading orators, the other hand which impels me to write a few words respecting it. He was the principal guest at the annual dinner of the local press club, and I have carefully perused more than one report of the speech in the several newspapers in which it has appeared. He said he was getting on in life and for some time past had withdrawn from public life and hoped that he had done with public speaking, the great terror of every public speaker in his time was the reporter, but to some extent and to what extent is apparent from a study of newspapers. Pressmen had ceased to report the speeches to which it was understood the whole community were looking forward with breathless interest. Dear Mr. Scott, for some time past I have been unable to write to you as I have desired and as I promised you when you were here. I hope you will not be annoyed at my apparent neglect. You should not be, and I am sure you will not be when you are aware of the reason for my silence. I have no doubt you will remember that I was not well previous to your visit, but I am sorry to tell you I have been under the care of Dr. Brown ever since the day you left. Indeed, you were not gone an hour when I had to send for the physician. I do not know what was the cause of my illness. I cannot say that I am aware of everything to which it due. I know of nothing to which it can be traced. At all events, it has been very severe, and for some time my recovery was considered hopeless. Of course, I am not yet out of the wood, and I must not boast, but I think I am fairly on the road to complete recovery. You will be sorry to learn that I am not yet strong enough to leave my room, but you must not suppose that I am in danger. I trust I shall be able to make an effort to visit you sometime during the coming month. At any rate, I am hoping so. I must leave off for the present, but will write again very soon. Yours truly, yours, Thomas Makin. At any rate, the speaker continued, the reporter was no longer the terror of public speakers, and now only reported the speeches of the great lions of the front bench. He believed that the press did work for the cause of progress, but at the same time he warned his hearers of their influence in the cause of peace. and implored them to hesitate before they did anything to bring about the horrors of war. It is on this question of war, he went on to say, that you are not yet one with me. You must not be vexed if I venture to repeat that I cannot see why you should condemn at all times and under all circumstances the influence of the press in this matter, as if it were the duty of the journalist, in so many words, to denounce all wars and cry for peace of every occasion. A notable writer says, war is sacred, and there can surely be no doubt that it is absolutely necessary to use force for the suppression of tyranny and wrongdoing. I may not be able to see you for a long time to come, so I hope you will not see you for a long time to come, so I hope you will not fail to write me on this subject. Doubtless, you will be able to find some objections to my statements. Still, I am able to think that you will modify your views in the early future, if it be not too much trouble to you. Will you kindly post to me the copies of the pamphlets I lent you some time ago, and although you may not have read all of them, perhaps you will give me your opinion on those you have perceived. We should exhibit charity in our words at all times, and in this spirit, I trust we shall always express our thoughts when writing to each other on controversial topics. Dear Mr. Scott, since I wrote you last, I have heard that you were injured slightly in a railway accident. Is this true? I trust not. If it is, you are not likely to be improved by my letter. If it is not, you will pardon my mentioning the report. In any case, you might send me word, and if you can spare the time, perhaps you will come over on Monday. If you cannot arrange this, please inform me from time to time how you are getting on with the new business, to which it appears you are devoting yourself. If it be as successful as you were inclined to think, you will be very fortunate, and if it be not quite so profitable as you hoped, it will still have proved an interesting experiment. At all events, it was well worth a trial. At the same time, you should not work too hard. If you do, you must not be surprised to find your health giving way. I have no doubt of the ultimate success of your patent, and if it were necessary, I could arrange to invest a considerable amount in the business. I cannot do anything in the matter of the shares you spoke about. Until I have seen you again, I cannot see that there is any hurry about the affairs. If it does happen that the shares are all taken up before I make application, I shall not mind very much. I am trusting, however, that you will be able to pay me a visit on Monday and explain matters. I have staying with me an old friend who has been out to South America for 3 years on business matters, and I am sure you will be delighted with his conversations on the customs and manners of the natives. I wish there were more people who would remember the saying that to understand everything is to forgive everything. In other words, whenever there is cause to criticize the actions of others, we should try to get at the real motive of the actions, and then we should be more charitable towards such persons. I know there will be some who will object to this view, but my dear friends, if there is to be a larger hearted sympathy abroad, I am sure there is no other way of attaining if it than that I am advocating, and no other way in which there is anything like so much chance of success. How can there be true brotherly feeling in our hearts if we condemn others before there is an opportunity of understanding their motives, and if we pass upon their actions a hasty judgment in order that there may be an advance in this matter? People will have to look above their own desires of making their way in life at all costs, and instead think of increasing their value to mankind in general. I know there has been a great deal said as well as written about the interest attaching to the study of phrase and fable, but I know there has not been sufficient said in view of the importance of the matter, and I know there will be a great deal more both said and written before the subject is exhausted. Whenever there is a subject of interest to the general reader and a desire expressed for information upon it, there will be found someone ready and willing to obtain the necessary knowledge and impart it to others. As we have seen too, the work is from time to time generally executed as well as it can be, and the results made known in the very shortest time possible. This is a great convenience to most of us, as we have not time to devote to research in these subjects. As Bulwer Lytton says, if we serve mankind, we serve ourselves. I believe there will be some who will say they will think about it, and pending their decision, I could urge them to reflect that men are naturally inclined to doubt the truth of such statements. Then there are others who hesitate in some other respects, perhaps in order to count on the material advantages or disadvantages of such a course for their own sake. I would ask them to change their view of life, and they are sure to benefit more than their worldly thoughts could possibly have suggested. The wise men of the past have assured us that, in their opinion, the best course of life is that which suppresses the selfishness inherent in man, and I think there will be many who, from their experience, will support them in their statement. Whether I address you as my dear sir, my dear madam, or my dear fellow citizen, let me ask you to ponder over this matter and to remember that in the beautiful words of Adelaide Proctor, glorious it is to wear a crown of a deserved and pure success. And though there is much that may baffle you in order to carry out this high ideal, it is as true today as ever it was that without sympathy nothing is understood. I think there is room, indeed, I am sure there is room for something more on the topic I have mentioned before. It can be said that the public is tired of it. There are some people, however, who know very little of the origin and meaning of many peculiar expressions of frequent occurrence. For their sake, for their satisfaction and pleasure, as well as for the educational advantage, it would be to them, I wish there were some means of bringing before their notice some of the books already published on this subject. If anyone says he does not need the sympathy of his fellows, he is not true to himself or to humanity, for the whole structure of society rests upon sympathy among individuals towards one another. If it were not so, then society as it exists today would be impossible. The strongest of us imperatively requires sympathy for some time or other. Our natures are certain to call for it, and if it is refused, that which is best in us becomes warped. History and literature furnish us with many examples of this. An unsympathetic nature is like the biting Arctic winds, but a sympathetic disposition is like the balmy breezes of the south, and the more expansive our sympathies, the more nearly do we approach towards the ideal of a deserved and pure success. I know there is a variety of opinion, however, on almost all questions, and if there be any of my readers who doubt the benefits to be derived from such a study as I have referred to, and if they assert that in their opinion it would be a waste of time as well as money to procure such books, I ask them for their own sake and for that of other people in their position who may look at the time, at the matter from their own view, to weigh the following points as carefully and as soon as they can. How often do we come across such phrases as toad eater, salted accounts, etc.? And though their meaning from their position in the sentence may be pretty clear, should we not have some difficulty in saying how they come to have their present signification? Have we not all occasionally read some phrase or heard some allusion which we did not understand? And have we not sometimes lost the beauty of a passage through our want of knowledge? I think there will be few who will dissent from this.